Good evening, everyone. Time for another member update. We're going to start out with a couple of charts. By the way, if you didn't see the interview on Reluctant Preppers that's posted on Silver for the People blog, that's an interview that I did about a week ago, and kind of talked about some different topics than the normal ones. So if you get a chance, listen to that interview. So this is the Bitcoin chart. This is the one from BTC-E. It's not the highest price chart, but it's probably the best formed pennant. And you can see it's nearly a perfect pennant. Now, again, these pennants fail. You can see multiple times that this pennant has failed, but it continues to build. The trend line is rising. So really bullish pattern that we're seeing right now in Bitcoin. We'll have to wait and see if we get that move up towards 500. Next chart I want to look at is one that gives me great joy, and that's the target chart. Just watching this stock fall, recently was reported that the American Family Association, who has 1.2 million signatures on their target boycott, met with the leadership of Target, and Target is not relenting on this. So looks like there's going to be quite a bit more pain for the stockholders of Target. And you can see that at one point, this is the year-to-date chart, you can see that at one point Target stock was up nearly 15% on the year, and now it's back down to even. This line chart here, that's the Dow Industrial, so you can see that Target has now crossed down below the Dow. Hopefully it takes out these two lows and we get a good 20 or 25% drop in the price of Target. It's being masked partly by the terrible retail numbers that are coming in and a lot of these other stocks. So it's kind of being poo-pooed, but I definitely believe that this has to do with the boycott. So let's get to the main story. It's gonna be about Venezuela. I know this is a dead horse that I've beaten so many times, but the situation is becoming so bad in Venezuela. We've had reports that people are hunting down and eating cats and dogs. We've had riots and huge looting situations and violence, and it's just a terrible situation. And in my opinion, the blame lies 100% on the shoulders of Nicolas Maduro, who, as I point out many times, is a complete madman. He's some Jesuit puppet Marxist lunatic, and he needs to be removed from power. Now, we had some hints recently from the president of Colombia talking about the same thing, that Maduro needs to go. And he's actually hinting at I was surprised, removing him from power. We're getting to the point now in the destabilization of Venezuela where, now I'm not big on interventionism, but if someone removed him from power, they'd be doing that country a favor. So let's look at some of the videos here. I'm going to start with Jeff Berwick, because myself and Jeff, we have been the two that have covered this story consistently and connected it to the real problem, which is socialism. I'm going to play a video from Hayek explaining why it's happening and why it's being caused by socialism. But let's listen to, this is Jeff interviewing one of the six supposed anarcho-capitalists in the country. And let's listen to this, and then we'll do some more videos.
Yeah, it's quite fascinating to see here in Venezuela. Things are so bad. There's lineups around the block just to go to an ATM bank machine and take out a maximum of $1 a day, which is about 1,000 bolivars. There's lineups down the block just to get into grocery stores. There's lineups for absolutely everything here. It's amazing that people, but still, we just drove through a part of town where it's Chavista town, and everyone loves Chavez and loves what he did for the country, but it's really bad, and they don't understand economics, do they?
Sí, bueno, la ciudad de Caracas ciertamente está dividida, más o menos lo que es de el municipio Chacao hacia el este. Se consideran territorios opositores y durante mucho tiempo se consideró que lo que era el oeste de la ciudad era un territorio chavista, como llegaste a ver varios grafitis en la calle. Pero eso ha ido cambiando con el tiempo, la gente ya está cansada de hacer colas y inclusive en las últimas elecciones, las parlamentarias, esta zona, por ejemplo, en la que nos encontramos ahorita, el gobierno quedó bastante destruido con sus seguidores.
Yeah.
Now, the results of that election have been reported fairly widely, but what hasn't been reported is the fact that there has been a huge reaction to that. And this is a interview with some of the opposition. This is done by the government of Canada, I think, the Canadian Senate, and these gentlemen are explaining what's going on in Venezuela as far as the jailing of the opposition, because that's what Maduro is doing. And this is a pattern. Not only do we have the suppression of the free market, but we have suppression of free speech, and we have suppression of the political opposition. All these things go together when you have a Marxist dictatorship.
In Venezuela, we have political prisoners. Not a single democracy can exist with political prisoners. 117 people are, 16 people are in prison. Three of them are members who were recently elected. Of the political prisoners, there's the leader of the party that Mr. Rondon represents. He was a presidential candidate in 2006. The another prisoner is the lawyer, the mayor of the city of San Cristobal. This is in the southeast of Venezuela. This one of the prisoners is the mayor of Caracas, the most important mayor in our country. There's another prisoner is the leader of our party, Freddy Guevara's party, and my party, Leopoldo Lopez. He has been in isolation for 27 months. And when you have a member of parliament jailed, essentially people feel being a month in jail is like being a year in jail. So to be in jail for 27 months is like being there for 27 years. This is a huge violation of human rights. And so we've put forward an amnesty law that was recently approved. This amnesty law was declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court.
And by the way, Maduro has packed the Supreme Court through corruption. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? And so, of course, that's the decision that was handed down. So he's consolidating power because the state is failing. Now, let's listen to this video of Hayek. Before we do that, though, this video was posted on Jeff Berwick's blog. And this is Bernie Sanders telling us that breadlines are a good thing.
You know, it's funny, sometimes American journalists talk about how bad a country is because people are lining up for food. That's a good thing. In other countries, people don't line up for food. The rich get the food and the poor starve to death.
So that's the socialist take that you have on that. Bread lines are a good thing. That's assuming that you're not going to run out of bread, but you do run out of bread. That's why you have riots and looting. So the fact that this lunatic, socialist, communist, fruitcake, nut job is actually a serious contender for the president of the United States. That's a very, very sad statement about the American electorate, especially the left in America. So let's listen to Hayek on socialism. This is a little bit hard to understand, but I'm going to summarize it when he's done.
But I just interrupt at that point. You say socialism is impossible in a technical sense. Now, what exactly do you mean by that?
It proposes a solution which is not the solution. You cannot, well, it takes a long time, but it's my central problem. Socialism assumes that all the available knowledge can be used by a single central authority. It overlooks that the modern society, which I now prefer to call the extended order, which exceeds the perception of any individual mind, is based on the utilization of widely dispersed knowledge. And once you are aware that we can achieve that great utilization of available resources, only because we utilize the knowledge of millions of men, it becomes clear that the assumption of socialism as a central authority in command all this knowledge is just not correct.
So what you're doing is you're turning on its head the common point one often hears from the left, that because the problems of modern society are so difficult, that they require planning. You're saying because they're so complex, they make planning impossible.
Well, I think the nicest form to put it is to say that socialism protesting against the production for profit and not for use objects to what makes the extended society possible. Production for use is only possible in a society where we know all the facts. But to achieve the situation where we are all working for people whom we do not know and are being supported by the work of people we do not know is made possible because we produce for profit. Profit is the signal which tells us what we must do in order to serve people whom we do not know.
Yes. Now, Ewan von Mises put forward this criticism in the 20s. What reaction did you get from the socialists of the day? What reply did they make to that fundamental criticism?
They were unwilling to admit the factual argument. They preferred to withdraw on the text. This is a difference of values on which science cannot decide. Once you accept the socialist values that we must be guided by a conception of just distribution, all the factual arguments are irrelevant. Well, of course, the factual arguments prove that the just distribution is impossible unless the distributor knows all the facts. So my answer is, if the factual assumption of socialism were correct, it would be a moral duty to aim at the just distribution. But you have to recognize you cannot do it. In fact, you can produce enough as to maintain the present population of the world only because of a spontaneous process or mechanism which enables you to make use of infinitely more information than any central authority possesses.
Okay, so to sum that up, to make it clear, what Hayek is pointing out is that free markets, capitalism, and the profit motive, they provide information that no central authority can possibly amass and can possibly utilize for the benefit of people. And that ultimately, if that factual information is prevented from being supplied, then ultimately, he said, the world's population cannot be sustained. In other words, he's saying that it's going to result in starvation. That's exactly what we're seeing in Venezuela, because the government is interested in suppressing factual information. Nothing proves that better than the story about Dolar Today. Now, Dolar Today is a site that I always go to that gives you information as far as the black market exchange rate of the Venezuelan Bolivar, which is the official rate is absolutely ridiculous. But the black market rate, I think it's 10 to 1 on the official rate, and the black market rate is 1,100 to 1. But what's so interesting about this Dolar Today story is the fact that the Venezuelan Central Bank actually tried to shut down this site in United States courts. So let's read this. Dolar Today is an American website that focuses on Latin American politics and finance. The company is more known for being an exchange rate reference to the Venezuelan Bolivar, a currency which is not freely convertible, is also known for the company's focus in monitoring the Venezuelan economy. Dolar Today was founded on May 18, 2010. It's headquartered in Miami, Florida. Prior to the election of Nicolas Maduro in 2013, Dolar Today was the second most popular exchange rate reference in Venezuela behind Lechuga Verde. However, when a scandal caused the demise of Lechuga Verde, Dolar Today became the most popular exchange rate reference. According to BBC Mundo, Dolar Today was founded as, quote, a form of protest against a dictatorship increasingly committed to silence and intimidate the media in Venezuela. Up until today, the company's website publishes criticism about the Maduro administration, which the founder states are selected by the site's writers based in Venezuela. Since its inception, Dolar Today has provided black market exchange rates that are updated daily for Venezuelans who cannot exchange currencies with the Venezuelan government for the dwindling supply of the U.S. dollar. The company based its computed exchange rates on the Venezuelan Bolivar to United States dollar from fees on trades in Cucuta, Colombia, a city near the border of Venezuela. Currently, with no other available source other than black market exchange rates, these rates are used by Reuters, CNBC, and several media news agencies and networks. The Economist states that the rates calculated by Dolar Today are erratic, but they are more realistic than the three official rates released by the Venezuelan government. The website maintains that the rates are not manipulated in order to undercut the Venezuelan government. Today, the exchange rate of the Venezuelan currency, monitored and governed by the Central Bank of Venezuela, is prohibited by the Venezuelan government from being accessed by its citizens. Thus, the exchange rates posted on Dolar Today are only accessible outside of Venezuela. Controversy. Dolar Today is used as a reference by several financial websites and medias around the world when it comes to reporting the Venezuelan exchange rate. In 2013, Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro banned several internet websites, including Dolar Today, to prevent its citizens accessing the country's exchange rates. Maduro, however, accused Dolar Today of fueling an economic war against his government and manipulating the exchange rate. According to Dolar Today, the Venezuelan government had been attempting to censor the website since November 2013. In March 2015, in a televised appearance, Maduro told the nation that he will ask United States Barack Obama for the capture of the owners of the company. In a press statement published in the government's website, Maduro's government said that it will exert all legal means against the company in response for defaming the Venezuelan economy. That month, the Venezuelan government attempted to censor the website and brought down websites Amazon, Snapchat, and Pinterest in the process. Since President Maduro made such comments, Dolar Today began to face blockages of their website almost every hour in Venezuela. Dolar Today then began using mirror sites on content distribution networks, placing cryptic links on their social media pages to sites since foreign social media sites are difficult for the Venezuelan government to censor. Each time a mirror site is blocked by the Venezuelan government, Dolar Today begins using a new one, with website engineers finding ways to automatically create a new mirror site every 20 minutes. On the 23rd of October 2015, the Central Bank of Venezuela filed a lawsuit against Dolar Today for allegedly falsifying the country's exchange rates. The lawsuit was dismissed by the United States judge on the 26th of February 2016, with the judge signing that court did not have the authority to take on the case and that the Venezuelan Central Bank lacked standing to sue. In response, the Central Bank filed an amended complaint on March 4, 2016, alleging specific injuries, including diminished seniorage, harm to the reputation of the bank, and deprivation of capital available to the bank. Approximately 1 million people visited Dolar Today's website daily in 2015. Dolar Today's Android and iOS apps were also among the most downloaded by mobile users in Venezuela. Also has 1.5 million Twitter followers, updating them with up-to-date exchange rates. The Venezuelan government, however, has viewed Dolar Today as a platform to launch an economic war against the government, with Fusion stating, Dolar Today's posts are becoming a source of increasing embarrassment to the Venezuelan government. The site is essentially reminding Venezuelans how life has become increasingly unaffordable under that country's socialist management. According to George Selgin of the Cato Institute, director of the Center for Monetary and Financial Alternatives, the lawsuit by Venezuelan government against Dolar Today, quote, offers a remarkable glimpse at the twisted logic of totalitarian regimes, and that if something were to happen to the website, the Cato Institute shares the same data and more on their Troubled Currencies Project website. Selgin regarding to the fact that the Cato Institute publishes the same information as Dolar Today. So if the Central Bank of Venezuela really wants to snuff out information concerning its mismanagement of the Bolivar, shutting down Dolar Today just won't cut it. It's going to have to shut us down as well. So how about it, guys? Our lawyers can't wait. So that's the story. That's not reported in the press. This is a totalitarian regime in Venezuela. It's a totalitarian dictatorship. It's a Marxist loony bin, and the people are starving. Nicolas Maduro needs to be removed from power. Now, If you think about what Venezuela has, it has the largest oil reserves in the world. It has a climate where it's tropical year-round. It's probably one of the best places for growing food, yet it's not just the fact that the Venezuelan economy is being prevented from functioning because of price controls and everything else, but it's also that the people of Venezuela, they're not growing their own food. They're hunting cats and dogs because there's just, when people live under a socialist regime, when they install socialist leaders like Bernie Sanders, and when these people get in power, these people never admit that they're wrong. They will never, socialists will never admit that they're wrong, even when their policies result in starvation. Even when they have a country rich in resources, I don't remember when it was, but Venezuela was actually one of the most wealthy countries in the world at one point. So this is what the socialists have done from Venezuela. Nicolas Maduro needs to go, and actually Venezuela could be turned around rather quickly if they just simply opened up the free market, removed all the price controls, allowed things to trade, allowed the currency to adjust to its true value, welcomed in things like Bitcoin, gold and silver trading. But unfortunately, socialists not only ruin economies, but they actually ruin the people themselves. They ruin the values that people have, and for that reason, it may take a very, very long time for Venezuela to recover, even if Maduro is removed, because once you instill this type of dependency in the people, where they depend on the government for everything, of course, once everyone is depending on the government for everything, then everyone gets nothing. And we'll talk to you next time.